Imagine you have an amazing night partying, only to wake up the next day inside a room-sized industrial kiln. We need to figure out who put us here and why they did it, and most importantly, how to survive 200 degrees. We see a small metal room with an unconscious man inside, zip-tied to a folding chair. As we will learn in just a bit, this is Ryan Hinds, a broker who was out celebrating a deal last night before all of this happened. Apparently, he had a real good time as we see a quick flashback of him and a buddy hooking up with some random women. He eventually comes to his senses and has a look at his surroundings. Above him hang four devices chained to the ceiling. They look a bit like lamps, but seem a bit redundant with the multiple lights already fixed inside this room. He looks forward and sees a rectangular window, but the other side is too dark to see anything through. Beneath the window is a small, short pipe with a clock and temperature gauge on it and a speaker between them. To his left, there is an airtight door sealed with a valve. Ryan then realizes that he is strapped to the chair. He immediately starts rocking around to build up momentum and fall over, and uses his body weight as a leverage to pull his arm until the zip tie breaks. Now, while we are looking at the floor, we see the ground is made of concrete, which is a good thing to observe in an otherwise all-metal room. After freeing his hands, he gets up and goes straight for the door. Now, I'm not sure how he got his other arm free, but let's just assume that he did that off camera. And of course, the door is locked. Frustrated, he starts shouting if anybody can hear him. Now, let's stop right here. If you awake tied up in an unfamiliar space, you likely have been kidnapped. And whoever abducted you doesn't want you dead yet. But they obviously want something from you. This means when you are awake, and especially if you're free from any restraints, don't start announcing those facts. Your kidnappers are most likely close by or watching you through cameras or windows, waiting for you to wake up so that they can start getting whatever it is they want. If you happen to get an opportunity to be alert or unrestrained without them knowing, then that is a perfect opportunity to try and escape. If, however, the kidnappers discover that you are free, they may attempt to subdue you again or even kill you if you are no longer worth the effort of keeping alive. Point is, keep quiet. If the kidnappers were actually concerned with you making enough noise to get help, they would have gagged you, right? Since they didn't and there is an airtight door, the only ones likely to hear us will be the ones we don't want to. Going for the door is a very obvious idea that is almost guaranteed not to work. The kidnappers would have to be extremely arrogant and really trust their restraining skills to leave our easiest escape route unlocked. Still, with that being the most direct means, we should give it a try, especially since we were restrained originally, so the kidnappers may not expect it. As Ryan stands around wondering what to do, his phone starts to ring. He had a cell phone on him this entire time. Why didn't he use it immediately to try and call 911 or anyone else for help? He may not know an exact location to give anyone, and we later learn that his signal is being routed, but he doesn't know that right now and should still at least try. No one can start looking for us if they don't even know that we're missing. The phone call is from his buddy Bruce. He is panicking on the phone, says he needs help, they want money, and they took him. Ryan can't get him to make any sense, but is able to get him to describe where he is. Bruce says that he is being held in a small metal room with a heavy door. He also says that there is heat coming down from the ceiling and the temperature is rising fast, complaining that it is so hot. Ryan realizes that Bruce is in a room identical to his and confirms it by asking if there is also a small window. This causes Bruce to panic even more now, claiming that they are going to die. Ryan tries banging on the walls and shouting in an attempt to see if Bruce can hear it to confirm his location. But Bruce is too distracted by the heat. Ryan tries to get him to focus on what he remembers from last night, but Bruce starts begging to make it stop as we hear a sizzling sound over the phone. He then starts screaming, saying that he is burning before the phone goes silent. Ryan tries to call back, but the phone is dead. He screams, "Let me out of here," because that always works with kidnappers. A high-pitched sound plays over the speaker, causing enough pain that Ryan holds his hands over his ears. A raspy and distorted voice asks if it has Mr. Hinds' undivided attention. Ryan can't ask anything and will be given one shot at answering the question. It then starts listing out the rules. Guess the answer and I will let you walk free right now. 2 minutes, as many guesses as you want. Just guess who I am. Say my name and all of this will end right now. So we have 2 minutes to just say one name and have infinite guesses. So what does that mean? Well, start guessing every single name we know immediately. Think especially of those that we have wronged or would have a grudge against us. This is too overly elaborate of a way to kill randomly, right? And with the amount of effort it would have taken to get Ryan and Bruce into those industrial kilns, and the fact that they want us to guess their name, it almost seems like it is personal. Instead of guessing right away, however, Ryan wastes time by grabbing the folding chair and repeatedly hits the window with it. He could have attempted this before having a task with a time limit, if you ask me. If he was going to waste time and hit anything, he should have tried to use that chair to break the lamps hanging overhead, which apparently are heaters. We probably wouldn't recognize them as heaters right away if we didn't know the title of the film, but we could have inferred it thanks to Bruce's description of his room heating up from the ceiling. Still, a better use of our time would be to start name guessing. Ryan starts to recount the events from the previous nights, saying that he arrived in Houston, signed a big deal with some investors, then went out celebrating. He remembers the names of the investors and the women, and says the voice is one of them. But the voice replies, "Wrong answer," and the hanging lamps turn on with a red glow. Now we see the temperature gauge start to rise to 120 degrees. Ryan asks for the heat to be turned off, because clearly the kidnappers didn't mean to turn them on. Although, the kidnappers shouldn't use the lamps right now. The rule said that Ryan had as many guesses as he liked, so there shouldn't be a wrong answer. It also had only been a minute and 20 seconds, unless the film isn't showing us scenes in real time or the rules are tenuous. Ryan uses the folding chair to reach the heaters and touches one, but remembers that metal gets hot as he burns his hand. He tries again using his coat to grab the chair before giving up, retreating to the corner and saying that he will do whatever the voice wants. The heaters turn off and the vents open up. A cooling fan starts blowing and Ryan rushes over to get some of the breeze, but they close shut just a few seconds later. The voice says that perspiration stains on your $300 shirt are the least of your worries, to which Ryan corrects them by saying it is a $500 t-shirt. Now, commenting on someone's expensive taste is a very clear indicator that this kidnapper is someone who has been wronged financially. Ryan should start thinking of anyone and everyone he has screwed over when it comes to money. The voice isn't amused by Ryan's correction and says to see if he is still joking when his flesh cooks and lungs are seared. This scares Ryan into taking the kidnapper seriously, asking what they want. The voice says it wants $1 million of your money. Either this was spoken in broken English, or it was phrased this way for a particular reason. Ryan says he doesn't have access to that kind of cash, but the voice just starts listing the new set of rules. You have 2 hours, the room starts at 100 degrees Fahrenheit, and every 5 minutes that goes by without the kidnapper being a millionaire will cause the temperature to rise 3 degrees. Time for some math. If 5 minutes equal 3 degrees, then at 15 minutes the room will be 109 degrees Fahrenheit. 30 minutes, 118 degrees, 1 hour, 136 degrees, and after 2 hours, 172 degrees. Not quite at the 200 degrees promised in the movie title, but we are getting close. At 118 degrees, my friends, human skin can sustain first-degree burns. A second-degree burn can occur at 131 degrees, and human skin is destroyed at 162. According to our math and data, we only have 30 minutes before we can't touch anything in the room, and 1 hour and 45 minutes before touching stuff will permanently damage us. As for survival, that varies drastically from person to person and the environment. But overall, the more humid the air, the harder it is for the body to regulate temperature through sweat, and the easier it is to overheat. So a dry heat really is the best way for us to survive. Ryan tries to plead with the kidnapper that even if he had months and sold everything, he couldn't reach that goal. But the voice doesn't care. He then starts talking about his family, how he doesn't have much money, and how his wife has to help with a part-time teaching job. As he starts talking about his son, the voice says that we know more than you think. They know when Ryan stopped wetting the bed and everyone who his wife dated before. It's a bit weird for the kidnappers to focus so much on one individual and yet still ask them for the money that they don't have. This must mean the kidnapper knows something we don't. They did one mistake, however, and that is responding with the pronoun we. This means they just gave away the fact that there is more than just one kidnapper. This fact combined with their knowledge means there are likely multiple close individuals with common interest against us. It is another clue to figure out who is doing this and why. Ryan then calls his brother, who is also a cop. Now we should call the police department before family members, even if they are officers themselves. If the kidnappers know so much about us, then they must already know about our relatives and have contingency plans to stop them from helping. Or worse, our family could be in on the kidnapping. We shouldn't rule anyone out. If anything, those closest to us have the knowledge about us. They would know our lives and routines to know when and where to strike, and usually have a more personal stake to do so. It would be better to call a neutral party. Ryan starts a conversation with a simple, "I need your help," and gets a sarcastic reply. But the brother eventually says that he will send a squad car and to leave the phone on at all times so they can track it. Call local police still though, the government and anyone who may value our life. Our brother being the only one searching for us is bad for a few reasons. More lifelines equals more chances at survival if something happens to stop one of them. A bigger group looking for us means they can help each other and cover more ground, meaning a faster rescue. And if our brother is in on the kidnapping, that means no one is actually looking for us, meaning always have backups. Now Ryan again tries to plead with the kidnappers and offers a watch worth $10,000 that he got from his father. The kidnapper says that they have no need for that and instructs Ryan to smash it, which he begrudgingly does. He now calls his wife Anna. He tries to not show what is happening and tells her not to ask any questions. And when she shows concern, he snaps at her. He claims to be in financial troubles and asks for all the money they were saving for their son Larry. She eventually, and miraculously, sends the money. Rule number one, when asking for help, don't be a douche. Others are less likely to help you or will take more time to convince. And both cases can lead to us getting overcooked. Try to explain the situation in a way so that they help you immediately or get others who can. There is no drawback in telling others except making them worry. But if they worry, they care. And if they care, they probably wouldn't want us to die. So let them help. Now we get a time lapse of him calling others, presumably asking them for money as well. The camera zooms in on the temperature gauge showing 129 degrees, which means it's been 46 minutes. At this point, we should be stripping off some clothing down to remain cool. A lot like Ace Ventura in The Mechanical Rhino. He gets frustrated and starts banging the folding chair against the walls. That is a terrible idea. This will exert us, causing us to die faster from internal temp rising. Keep calm. Also, that chair would likely give us a first-degree burn at this point as well. If you're going to swing it, try breaking the heaters at least. John, Ryan's cop brother, calls back and says to remain calm. They are right outside with a full SWAT team. Ryan then shouts at the kidnappers, "You hear that? F*** you." Well, don't start celebrating before you're actually rescued. There could be booby traps for the police, a la Saw style, and the cops may not be able to get to you before the kidnappers crank the heat to "well done." I mean, doesn't he know there is still an hour left in the film? John calls back to say, "Sorry, bro." Apparently, the signal from Ryan's phone had been routed to an empty building, meaning the SWAT team is at the wrong place and Ryan could be located anywhere. John also says there is a note that reads, "I have them," implying that Ryan's family has been kidnapped as well. This would be less likely to happen if Anna had been warned of the actual situation instead of just being told it's financial troubles. This also could be happening due to John being the kidnapper, right? He could make it seem like he sent someone to watch Ryan's family, when in reality he is kidnapping them himself, which is something that could possibly be prevented if more than just one person was informed. Ryan calls back Anna, who claims that someone is trying to get into her house. He tells her to go upstairs and lock herself into the bathroom and that the police are on their way. Anna should not lock herself in a bathroom. This is a kidnapper we're dealing with. She needs a spot that has an emergency exit, such as a bedroom, preferably on an upper floor with a window to jump out of. Bedrooms also allow for the door to be barricaded with furniture, more so than a dead-end bathroom. It is a Zombieland rule for a reason, my friends. Anna should also arm herself, if possible, with anything she can find, and contact the cops herself in case Ryan is mistaken about them coming. Anna says, "I'm scared. They're going to kidnap me too," before we hear the dial tone. Now, Anna claiming that she was going to be kidnapped is interesting, because Ryan never said that he was kidnapped. This means either Anna was able to put two and two together and realize Ryan was kidnapped, despite his best efforts not to inform her, which is fairly believable since being stressed can make you snappy and kidnappings are typically for money. Or Anna is in on a kidnapping to harm Ryan and take his money, and she accidentally let it slip. Suddenly, the four nozzles on the faucet in the corner start spraying water. Ryan cowers in pain in the middle of the room, using the folding chair as a shield, begging for them to be turned off because it's burning him. If the water is harmful, move out of the way, dude. The water isn't stun-locking you, so don't lay in the middle of the room. We should go underneath the faucet. It sticks out a decent amount and sprays the water outward, meaning it should be completely dry underneath. Another option would be going to the opposite corner. The nozzles are not spraying hard enough to reach the other side. This is obvious when the water is turned off and we see the remaining droplets hit the ground. There are only ripples in the center of the room, meaning be anywhere else. But the real danger here is humidity. As stated before, survival in hot environments varies, but a consistent factor is the humidity in the air. Ryan's internal body temperature will be increasing even faster now. This means he will be getting more dehydrated and his blood vessels will expand further, meaning less oxygen reaches the brain, making it harder to think and act. So what can we do about this? Well, we could plead to the kidnappers, tell them we can't get their money if we're dead, and have them adjust the temperature at least a little bit to compensate for the humidity increase. They most likely wouldn't though, so the next option would be to take our clothes off and try to use them to soak up the water. Now we can attempt to use our soak clothes to short circuit the heat lamps by tossing or swinging them at them. We could try and cause some damage with the folding chair first to expose either the bulb or the wires for the water to get to. It's a long shot, depending on how much water we can actually get to the lamps, but if it could instantly put an end to the current threats, it is worth a try. If that doesn't work, we could at least wring them out into our mouth. This is a bit gross, I know, but drinking the water will rehydrate us and leaves less water in the air. Ryan now asks where Anna is and the kidnappers simply say she is safe. He doesn't ask about his son though, which is strange since the kidnapper's note implied that they were taking both of them. Whatever. Ryan then asks how much more money he needs to raise and the voice tells him he needs over $900,000 more. So, if the clock we see is to be believed, he has been at this for an hour and 6 minutes and couldn't even get to 100k. But Ryan gets newfound confidence and goes into super broker mode. He starts calling all of his wealthy connections and tells them a bunch of lies about products and information, convincing them to donate hundreds of thousands of dollars. Basically like the Wolf of Wall Street. Ryan is trying to save his own life, but he could possibly be ruining others, like the one client saying that he is giving all of his money that he has. Just because they are rich doesn't mean they are terrible or deserve to lose everything. However, I don't blame Ryan here. We need to do what it takes to survive and our lives are worth it. The other option though is to ask these clients for their help. They may be willing to just give us the money if it's to save us during what is essentially a hostage negotiation. Eventually, Ryan starts to almost faint. Either the phone malfunctions or he is too delirious to read it correctly. He passes out and fantasizes about breaking the lamps with a folding chair. Not sure why he only attempts this in his dreams and not in real life? Question mark. Now Ryan wakes up and continues to lay on the floor, directly under the lights. He should at least move to be out of the direct heat, no? John now calls back to say that they got a hold of the cell phone company and they have narrowed Ryan's location down to a 15-mile radius. Not sure why they couldn't do that before, but okay. Ryan gets a call back from one of his clients to turn him down. They have changed their mind and want to give him the money. This last payment puts him at $1,054,000. If the temperature was still increasing at this point, the room would be at least 169 degrees Fahrenheit, well above the 1 hour limit for surviving in 140 plus, according to this chart. Ryan asks for the heat to be turned off now, but the kidnapper says the rules were $1 million of your money, and that they only wanted $1 million and were going to let him keep the rest. This rightfully pisses Ryan off and he wants an explanation. The voice reveals that it knows that Ryan has $4 million set aside. Are you kidding me? He has that much money, yet he was willing to die instead of giving up some of it? It's like 25%. He also took from family and friends, putting several of them in desperate states. If that is true, I can see why he was kidnapped. Ryan begs for another chance and the voice agrees, but the rules have changed. Ryan now has only the remaining time left, which is less than 5 minutes, and must transfer all $4 million to the kidnappers. The kidnappers then send Ryan's account information proving its existence and say they even have the password. Ryan wants to know why they're doing all of this then, to which the voice responds that it wanted to give him a chance at redemption. Now, the best solution now would be to just give them the money they want. They clearly know way more than we realize and want to see us part with our money willingly. So we should give them what they want to avoid further harm. It's just money. It's a lot of money, I know, but it's still just money. No amount is worth our life. And our bank could even potentially get it back for us later if we report this. The heat lamps start lowering, increasing the temperature in the room, somehow, which doesn't make sense, which causes Ryan to shrink to the floor. He calls the bank and transfers the money with a Delta transaction. The heaters turn off and the door's valve handle starts to turn. Someone enters the room and leaves. Ryan apparently passed out and starts to dream about his family. Now some time passes and the cooling fans kick on, reviving Ryan. This would be the perfect opportunity to stick our shoes or clothes into the gaps to keep the vents open. Now the kidnappers slide a piece of paper into the room through the mail slot. It's a list of names that Ryan recognizes as his family members, but the voice tells him to read them out loud anyway. It's Anna, his wife, Larry, his son, Valerie and Greg, his mother and father, and then he hesitates and gets angry about the next name on the list. It's Leslie, presumably his mistress. The final name on the list is John, his brother. The phone then rings and it's Anna, who says the kidnappers are letting her talk and she asks what's going on. Ryan says that he will explain later. Now is a pretty good time, as ever, to explain things, my friend. Take 5 seconds to say, kidnapper is extorting me for money. It's pretty simple. Ryan asks Anna where she is and she describes the same type of kiln room, meaning she is likely to be cooked alive if Ryan doesn't play along. The voice then says to Ryan that if he tells the truth, both he and Anna can walk away. At this point, just absolutely tell the truth to her and the kidnappers. They clearly have too much information on our life for us to get away with any sort of lie. And they now have Anna's life hostage too. Anything we say to her can always be refuted later as, you know, being under stress or whatever. First question that is being asked is, what is your name? Answer, Ryan Hinds. The kidnapper then asks if this is your only name, and Ryan says yes, because he obviously learned nothing about how serious this killer is and how much information they have. The heaters come back on and he quickly changes his tone, claiming to have 4 or 5 other names, but the voice claims that even that is another lie. Now Anna starts complaining about it getting hot, which, you know, fair enough, indicating that her room is rising in temperature too. The kidnapper presses the question again, and Ryan responds with dozens. It instructs him to look around the room for a little gift they have left. Apparently, there was a small box in a corner after he woke up, and he somehow did not notice. Ryan opens the box and finds a finger with a wedding ring still attached. Leslie's voice can be heard through the speaker now too, and she calls his name and asks what is going on and why it is so hot. The kidnapper then asks what is the truth. Ryan confesses that Anna is his wife. Leslie is suddenly confused as to why Ryan has another wife. Apparently, he has married both women. What the f***? Ryan explains they're both his wife, but he just wanted Leslie for her money and didn't care about her at all. Well, well done. Now, he apologizes and then also apologizes to Anna, stating that he was at least honest with how much he loves her and their son. The phone rings again. It is John. They've got a lead from the cell phone company and will be there in 15 minutes. The voice then instructs Ryan to pull the gun out from the box. Wait, there was a gun in there as well? I know the finger grabs your attention, but why wouldn't you notice a gun? Now the final test begins. The kidnapper says Ryan can shoot himself and his two wives will go free, or the other option is to let Leslie and Anna die while he goes free. The choice is his. Now before picking an option, there are some things we can try. Check the gun to see if it's even loaded. This might just be a test to see if we actually would pull the trigger. And if it is loaded, then it would be good to know how many shots we have. Shoot yourself in the arm or foot is another idea. You, in quote, shot yourself, like the voice asked you to, so the girls go free and you get to live. Now the kidnappers probably wouldn't let this slide, but who knows? Shoot the heat lamps. If you can break the bulbs, you may be able to stop the heat and live longer. We would still be trapped, and Anna's room is still heating, but we are alive for a second chance for escaping. Ryan chooses to shoot himself. However, the gun was empty. That is why he should have checked first. Now the door opens and Ryan slowly gets to it and leaves. He comes out into a small workspace and looks around. John shows up, brandishing a gun, but is in civilian clothes, and he is alone. Shouldn't he be in uniform and surrounded by a police squad? But instead of giving any possible excuse, John believes the gig is up and aims his gun at Ryan. Ryan is confused as to why John would do this. Now John asks dozens of questions to get Ryan to figure everything out, instead of just explaining. Apparently, he just loves asking questions. John brings up his deceased son, Adam, who was severely sick a year ago and needed an expensive treatment that insurance wouldn't pay for. So John met up with Ryan to ask for a loan, but Ryan didn't even ask what the money was for. Instead, he just turned his brother down, claiming times were tough. However, John never said why he needed the cash either, because he, in quotes, couldn't find the words. Now, I don't mean to sound unsympathetic for someone losing any loved one, but if you need something with life and death on the line, you should find the words to ask. Seems asking for money in desperate times without giving any reasonable explanations runs pretty decently in this family. Now, John originally accepted that Ryan couldn't help back then, but later found out about the millions he hoarded and the double life Ryan had. He was reporting for a call of a break-in that just so happened to be Leslie's home. There, he noticed her wedding pictures with Ryan in them. Now, Ryan still can't believe he would kill people over this, but John then reveals he didn't kill anyone. Bruce was just bribed to say what he wanted, and the wives, well, they make their dramatic reveal and walk out. They say they did this to teach him a lesson that would change his life and let him feel what they have felt inside. Leslie adds that they also wanted the money. Now Anna asks Ryan if he meant it when he said that he was sorry or that he loved her and their son. He responds, "With all my heart." The two seem happy for a moment until Leslie pulls out a gun and shoots her in the back. Ryan comforts Anna as she dies. Now why does John just stand there and do nothing? Isn't he supposed to be a cop? I know he is already breaking many laws doing this revenge plan, but he still cares about innocent lives, right? Also, why doesn't Leslie shoot everyone else? If it was just about money, it makes no sense to keep the others alive. Maybe she just wanted to make Ryan suffer, but if that's the case, then she should shoot John as well and not leave someone back who could go against her plans. She points the gun at John now as she walks over to the laptop and says that the money is leaving the account. Ryan smugly asks if they actually thought they could swindle a swindler. Leslie says Ryan is bluffing and points the gun at him now, but the moment her gun is off of John, he, without hesitation, shoots her as well. Well, Ryan, unfazed by Leslie's death, and John, unfazed by taking a life, continue their conversation about how he figured out the kidnapping was fake. we see a flashback to when Ryan was talking to Anna as she was being abducted. Turns out that she did accidentally let it slip by claiming that she would be kidnapped too. The next clue was when Ryan was told to smash the watch because apparently John was always jealous that their dad gave it to Ryan. Lastly, Ryan says that the finger was a giveaway as well, which is extremely late in the game to be figuring out that everything is fake. What gave away the finger? Well, the fact that it wasn't Leslie's finger. When John asks how Ryan could possibly know that, he just says, well, details, and doesn't elaborate any further. John then inquires where the 4 million went, and Ryan reveals that a Delta transfer is actually a security exercise where they move money from an account for an hour and then put it back. If the bank could have done this at any time, why didn't Ryan have them do this for the original $1 million the kidnappers were asking for at the very beginning? That doesn't make any sense. Now at this point, John suggests that they just clean up all of this and walk away as if nothing happened. Look, Ryan is a scumbag and a liar, but he didn't do anything illegal, other than maybe marrying twice, for what we know. Meanwhile, John here is kidnapped, extorted, and murdered, arguably in self-defense for the last one, but he is going to jail or worse for sure, so we should not agree to walk away and forget. However, he is still the one holding the gun, so maybe we should just act like we're agreeing with him, and then, while performing the cleanup, just kill him or, you know, whatever, and claim it's self-defense. We could take John to jail, but that leaves someone alive who could come back for revenge later. Now we see Ryan contemplating John's offer before cutting to him walking outside. We then cut back and see John in the burning room while he bangs on the window asking Ryan to let him out, but Ryan is long gone already. Now the camera shows a temperature gauge in the room reaching 200 degrees Fahrenheit, which at least shows that the title wasn't a lie, unlike that sauna movie. So, that was the movie 200 Degrees, my friends. If we were in a similar situation, we could just give the money, hopefully getting it back an hour later. It's that simple, isn't it? Thank you for watching, my friends. I see you again next week. Peace out and take care.